Well, I'm going to do a series of videos on rebuilding the transmission in this car. This is a 89 LeSabre with the LN3 3800 and the 440 T4 transmission. It has going on a 500,000 miles on this powertrain, and the engine's been rebuilt once, transmission's been rebuilt once before this time, and the pump bearing went out and damaged the pump housing and put some metal shavings through the system. Before I found out about that type of contamination, I was going to do this as an in-frame rebuild and show the procedure of taking the transmission components out through this wheel well without having to pull the transmission. But when I found the pump shaft damage, that meant that the shavings had gone into the torque converter, and I had to pull the whole thing out. At that point, I was going to do just a bunch of still pictures, and so I don't have video of the teardown, but what I'm going to do is make a slideshow, and I might narrate it a little bit for the first part. But then when it comes to the reassembly, I have actual video with a camera tripod of me putting the transmission back together. I'm all the way through to the running it on the stands and the test drive. I'm not trying to teach anyone to rebuild the transmission by watching videos, because you've got to have these books. This is the factory service book for the transmission, 440 T4. This is the number 1 and number 2 update books. These show all of the factory changes throughout the years and suggested modifications to make sure that you build a quality product when you get your rebuild done. I don't represent these people, and I hope that people don't take me as trying to put out an ad for them, but this is just the company that I use. And I'll put the link to their website in the description. Also, the parts that I ordered came from a Transtar company, which is another company that you can order parts from online. They're a supplier to many professional transmission shops and parts houses. That's where I got all the parts to do this job. And after this point, I'll get on to the pictures of the teardown. And it's going to be more than one video because of the time involved, so it could be either 3 or 4 different segments. And we'll take it one step at a time, and hopefully people will not be as intimidated by what's in the transmission and maybe encouraged to not end the life of their car and send it to the junkyard if they have transmission trouble, and maybe can keep it on the road a little bit longer. Thanks. Since originally this was going to be an in-frame, I set the car up on stands and prepared to take out the front subframe. Took out the strut and all the parts that are connected to the subframe, and then I removed the trans pan, found a little bit of shavings, nothing too bad. I wasn't expecting to have to pull it, but I did. The bottom accumulator cover is exposed. You'll need to take every component off the bottom that you can at this point. The two pistons around things with the pins have to come out. There's a spring behind them. Must go back in the same place, so take them out one at a time. The springs are color-coded, but make sure you note where they go. Two different lengths. They will fit in the wrong holes, and it will cause trouble. All the parts from the bottom laid out in a clean tray in the right order. The next little tube that comes out with the screwdriver is an oil supply. It has to be out, or else you cannot tear down the transmission in frame. There it is out. If it's still in there, you can't slide the driven sprocket support out. Okay, a few more pieces to come off the bottom. Another oil dam and a clamp has to come off. There it is off of there. The goal is to be able to put the pan back on and then put some wooden blocks and support it with jacks, because as an in-frame, you're going to be taking the subframe out and using those jacks to tip it down so you can take the end cover off, because all the parts come out through the end cover, and you have to have the subframe out of the way in order to do that. Looks bad, but it's really not that bad. The subframe is kind of lightweight, and one person can handle it, and there's one bolt that holds it on in the left corner on the front,
and then a few screws on each other end. You really only need a 13 and a 15 wrench and socket to get that subframe out. It's not that hard at all. Lower things down on the jacks using the wooden block to protect the bottom of the transmission. You may have to move some power steering lines out of the way to get clearance. Take all the pan bolts out for the end cover. Try not to get too much dirt in there. You have to tip it down a lot to get it out. There's not a lot of room, but it can be done. Okay, there's the pan off. We can see the pump and the switches. Making notes of where all the wires go, which color wires go to which switch. Something to write down. The book has that. It's different for most of the years, so make sure that you note it and get it back right, because that end cover is hard to get off. Okay, I found the problem. Pump bearing is bad. The shaft is worn down. I can see scoring in the pump where the pieces of the bearing went through there. This is a bad problem. You can see the circle red, the gouges in the aluminum. The reason that's serious, all that metal went through the valve body and the torque converter. There's the shafts undersized in the red block where the bearing cut into the metal. Because of the shaft damage and the bearing damage and the debris, I will have to take the transmission out, so this no longer will be an in-frame. There's the all the hardware for the pump and valve body. Put the hardware in a clean tray and cover it. Now, channel plate is off, fourth gear clutch, all those parts coming out. The linkage for the manual valve comes off. That's what actually puts it in gear when you move the lever, but it has to be disconnected. Take the snap ring off. This is important, because you can't get that shaft out without taking the torque converter out, so the sprocket has to slide off the shaft. Take off the axle retaining clip, because some other parts have to slide off over that. Now the chain can come off with the two sprockets all together. Put it aside. Now take two of the pump bolts, long bolts, to use as a handle, and you can pull out the driven sprocket support. And there it is. That's all the clutches in the transmission all together. Set that aside. Now the plastic needle roller bearing comes out. That supports one of the sun gears around the shaft. This piece cannot come out yet. If you do an in-frame, you won't want to take that out. None of the other parts can fit out of there, but you have to reach behind them and get out the 1 and 2 band. But be careful not to break the little plastic lube dam. There's the band coming out around everything. This band is still good, but I needed to check it. Got it out. You can slide it back in the same way. Just don't break the little plastic lube dam. Now the sprocket support, taking the snap ring off. This will get access to the fourth clutch piston seals. There, the fourth clutch is apart. A little bit of metal shavings down inside there around the piston. All the piston seals off. Gonna change all of them. They all come in the kit. Second gear clutch, taking the retaining ring out. Make sure and remember which side faced up on the retaining ring, because it needs to go the same way. Those clutches are a little bit darker than they should be, but probably slipped a little bit due to the pressure loss. Next snap ring, going to take the clutch return springs out of the second gear clutch, pulling it out by hand. You notice so far no special tools have been needed, nothing but hand tools. There's a return spring coming out of there. Next thing will be the piston, and I got to clean down below the piston to make sure there is no shavings. You can see the sparkle on the edge of that piston. That's metal shavings from the pump failure. All right, input housing. Input clutch and third clutch have to come out. More snap rings, more clutch discs. Make sure that keep everything in order so it all goes back in exactly the same way. Next little snap ring is very thin. It needs to be laid out in the correct side facing out, so it goes back together the same way. Those clutch plates look fine. Now I'm going to change piston seals in the input housing and clean it out, removing that to retaining ring. That return spring, retaining ring coming out. Now the piston is out. All kinds of shavings in there to have to clean out. Next one, this snap ring is hard to get out. There's another spring below it that's pretty strong. And putting this one back will require a special tool, but it's homemade. It's very easy to do. Getting the rest of the parts of the input housing out to see more shiny metal shavings on that. That's the reason this all has to be clean after this kind of failure. Got everything laid out in clean plastic bins. Keep the dust off of it. Now, going back together, everything clean. Clean with brake cleaner, blow with air, make sure there's no metal chips or anything kind of grit on it. Compare the new and the old seals out of the kit to match like for like, very simple. Use the trans gel. It's a light grease that won't contaminate anything. Use it to lubricate the piston seals. Fourth clutch piston seals are on. Getting ready to slide that clutch piston back in its housing. Put trans gel on it so that it slides in easy. Going in with that, use the green circle, the lip wizard, to guide the seal lips in. Makes it go together more easily. Just push it in there. It shouldn't take force at all. If it takes force, the rubber seal is caught and you might tear it up. All right, it's in. Now I've got to go on with the return spring and the retaining ring. The return spring and retaining ring just go in the same way they came out. Just push it down, start the ring, and pry it over with the screwdriver. And there it is. That's the fourth clutch piston done. Now the sealing rings and expanders go on the where the second clutch basket fits. That's a quad ring, a four-lobe ring. It sits in the groove to help press out the plastic seal ring and keep it under tension. I mark it with a permanent marker on the outside edge. That way, if it rolls while it goes on the shaft, I know that the correct side is still out. You can see the black mark is out all the way around, not rolled any left or right. Now the sealing rings, plastic Vespel seal rings, go on top of the expander. Second clutch, new piston seals on the piston. Some trans gel to lubricate it, put it back together, use the lip wizard device to help guide the seal without damage. Now the return spring, it just sits down in there. It has to go in the correct way, only properly function one way, the book shows you. Now the retaining ring goes in place. Just slide it in there by hand, push it all the way down, use a screwdriver to push it down into the groove, and it goes in quite easily. Now, in the input housing, there's an O-ring and a couple seal rings on the shaft. They're kind of tricky because you can't really see down in there because it's so deep. So be very careful with these. Look at the book. Study the old ones as you take them out and make sure that you get them in there right. This is kind of a critical area. It's easy to make a mistake. There's the old seals out of the input housing. And the new seal is installed. Put the trans gel on there to lubricate it. Now the first piston is going in. It's deep down in there, so you really have to use the green lip wizard device. Now this is a special tool I had to make to press the parts together. It's just a hole in the workbench with a piece of threaded rod and a C-shaped piece of steel. Nothing high-tech at all. It presses that down, compresses the return spring, and it holds it down where the snap ring can be put on with the snap ring pliers. And once that part is done, no more need for the special tools for that. You can take the pressing bar off, and that's parts together. The next piston and return spring can just be put in by hand. It takes a good bit of hand strength, but it can be done. It's not that hard. And the retaining ring going in. Now you've got that part together. There's a couple of seal rings, or three, on the shaft. You really don't need to mess with them unless they're damaged. That's them right there. If they're good, leave them be, because you have to have special expander and resizing tool to get them in. Now go back with the clutches. They go in exactly the way they came out. Just be mindful of which side is out on everything. If there's any question, read the book, and you need to know what year your car is, what year your transmission came from. Because there are a lot of things that change. I'm going to put the second clutch onto the driven sprocket support to help press in those new seal rings to make sure that they not going to get caught when the transmission goes back together. So I can see them when I assemble it on the bench, and I can see that they're not getting broken. After that's been on there overnight, they'll stay in a little bit, make it easier to assemble the transmission. So put that together like you see it and set it aside. Keep it keep those seal rings compressed. Now there's a thrust bearing in the bottom of that. Set it in there too. Those seal rings will be connected. And then at this point, turn it over, and it's time for an air check.
Okay, I'm going to demonstrate the air checking of these clutches. I've got all the clutches assembled for this 440 transmission. When the transmission is fully put together, the valve body sends oil down these ports to activate the different clutches for the different gears. The reason I've marked an X on that one, this is the fourth gear clutch. And this piece here is the fourth gear clutch piston. And because there's nothing to restrain it, if I put air pressure there, it'll push it all the way out and blow the seals, and then the snap ring will be in a horrible bind and I'll never be able to recompress it and get it apart. And it really damages every part of this, so it's critical. Never air check that with any significant pressure. If you put maybe a tiny bit of pressure and just see this move a little bit, but I don't have the proper valve and blower on my compressor to do that safely, so I'm not going to even attempt it. So that one's marked with an X, but these other three here should activate the clutches in the bottom, and you should hear it. And my air hose has a little crack in the tip, so there will be some leaking, but it shouldn't be leaking from down in the bottom. So here goes. You can hear the clutch actuate. There's no air blowing down here, just a little bit around the tip. So that one's okay. That one's working. That one too. So it looks like the clutches are okay. That's to check the seal rings around the shaft. And the piston seals and the clutch pistons themselves. So hope that explains the reasoning for that and the reason for that one not being tested. If you look, when this one activates and the piston pushes out, all the clutch plates are in there, and then there's a snap ring right here, so it can't just blow the piston seal all the way out. So it's okay to check those because they're a complete clutch. With the fourth clutch, it depends on the bolted together, rest of the transmission being bolted together to restrain it. There you go.
Okay, now for the valve body. It's critical this part is completely clean and all the parts in there move freely. If there's any dirt or shavings caught in there, the transmission will not work right and it might be damaged again. This one, there you can see a piece of debris sticking that valve right in the center of the picture, a little bitty piece in there. It's hard to see, it's small, and in a moment there will be a picture where I have that little particle out on the tip of my finger, and that is all it took to stick that valve. I used the pressure wash to wash that valve body with degreaser, and it will help to get the dirt out from around the valves because the water pressure is so much it will move the springs and shift the valves and flush away the dirt. So that is critical. Grind it down that little groove where that valve can get stuck.
I want to go over some things on this valve body. Normally, if you have some problem with the transmission, clutches go or something, some mechanical failure, you don't really need to disassemble this. It has a lot of parts in it and it's very tedious, but I just want to go over some things I've learned working on these 440 transmissions. Some of the valves are either shifted or not shifted. They make their full stroke every time they move, and those usually don't get stuck. over on this part, those are the ones that normally shift fully. You can see moves freely. All those move freely. The worst one is this one, this valve train right here. That's the throttle valve. When you step on the gas pedal, this is pressed in mechanically. It's linked to the pedal. So if this valve gets stuck, it has an external force pushing this in, and it's going to go in no matter what. But it only has hydraulic pressure to return it. So if it's stuck, there's some dirt around it, and it gets forced in by this, the hydraulic pressure will never push it back, and so you'll be stuck in passing gear forever. And just drive around, in first gear, and your life will be really slow and boring. And you use a huge amount of fuel. But anyway, change hands with the camera. You see, down in this area, light better. I may have to edit some of this wasted time out, but the light does not want to cooperate. There's a little part right down in here. It's in line with this plunger. When I push the plunger, you see that move? If that last little part doesn't move perfectly freely when you push the plunger, and I mean perfectly freely, there's any kind of binding or jumping to it, you're probably going to have trouble. So this whole valve train needs to be perfectly clean. That's the most critical one. And the second one, this one with this small pin on it, that's the pressure regulator for the pump. That one tends to get stuck. It has a strong spring, so it's not nearly as bad as the throttle valve, but it needs to be moving freely. And this clip, as y'all probably remember from Project Camilla, getting stuck, clip on the groove in the valve. Make sure that doesn't get stuck. All the valves move freely. Another one that's a regulating valve, not an on or off, is this one right next to the lockup solenoid. That is the pressure regulator for the torque converter. It needs to move freely. And that one, the spring down here, is part of an update to all these transmissions, and it comes in a shift kit. Give it more pressure to make the lockup hold up better. This valve directly in line with the solenoid is the actual shifting valve for the lockup. And you can see it moves freely. So all of them, every last valve in here, you need to check. Make sure they all move. And the cleaning of this thing, if it's still shifting okay, but you've got damaged clutches or some broken parts, just clean it with brake cleaner and air. Don't do anything to it that could contaminate it or get water in it. This one had a pump shaft failure, had all kinds of metal shavings in it, and I wasn't even sure if it would be able to be saved or not, because these can get so stuck that you can't even get them out of the valve body without breaking them. But I think it's okay. I started with the pressure wash and the degreaser. And the power of the pressure wash is so much that it will remove the metal chips from around the valves, and it will actually shift the valves for you. You spray the pressure down behind these valves, it will actually push them and work the springs, and the water will flush away the debris. That's the first step. If there's any metal chips in here and you try to disassemble this, they'll get stuck in there and seize up the valves, and you've ruined the valve body. So it has to be completely clean. And to quote a buddy of mine from a previous job, don't wash it till it's clean, wash it till it's hot. And then you know that there's no grit or dirt still in it. And then blow it out with air to get the water off and spray it with the penetrating oil. Keep air blowing and spraying with penetrating oil, and you may find that most of the valves start working. There's a couple of them that are inside a bushing, not there, inside. And some of these bushings you have to remove in order to check the valve and clean it. And it's important not to leave water and degreaser in there. So any valve you can't see from the backside, you need to take the bushing out and make sure it's dry and clean. every one of these valve trains has a lineup of parts, and the service manual shows how it all goes together. Shows what each valve does. But the critical thing is to separate the parts. If you take it all apart, I use this organizer. Maybe this first bin will be everything out of this valve train, second bin here. And that will help you to get it back together the same way it came apart. Take lots of pictures. As I said, hopefully you don't have to tear into this. Usually, if a bearing or a gear or the clutches fail and the crap falls down into the bottom of the transmission and it can't get past the filter, and this is fed only with filtered oil through the filter, through the pump, to the valve body. But since I had a failure of the shaft of the pump between the filter and the valve body, that's where the debris was introduced. So it got this and it got the torque converter full of debris. And this is the source of the debris right there. This the pump drive shaft. That step is not supposed to be there. It's all supposed to be this size, not that size. All that remainder of that metal is gone, and the pump itself is all scored up, and then you can see the damage to the cover. So to make a long story short, I had to go get another core transmission from the junkyard to get the charge pump. The calibration to match the transmission to the car is in this valve body, the different springs and sizes of the valve. So it's very important. If I had to replace the valve body, I would have to find one from the exact same car, exact same year, same gear ratio, same engine, everything the same, or else it wouldn't work the same. It might work, but it wouldn't be the same. So I want to try to keep this one. But the pump, I don't want to start quoting year models, but all of the later model transmissions, the pumps are the same. And this ATSG book has all the details of which pumps are interchangeable. But throttle valve works, so wrap this up in paper and put it away until it's ready to go back on. Okay, I'm going to show how to get out a blind roll pin. If there's a hole drilled all the way through from the back, you can punch it out. But this one, there's no hole from the other side, so the only way to get it out is to extract it. And I've got this little piece of hard steel flat stock ground down to a point. This actually came with the shift kit for this purpose. And simply stick it down into the roll pin like that. Turn it, you'll feel it grab. There's the roll pin. The trick is to turn it in the direction that's going to tighten the roll pin up on itself. So roll pin is actually a spiral of thin sheet. And pull that out that way using this little homemade tool. And then this can be disassembled. The roll pin would go in that groove and lock this bushing in there. So that's how you get those roll pins out when you don't have a hole from the back to use a punch.